Good morning and welcome to the 29th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2023. Today we have apologies from Jackie Dunbar and Jim Fairley is attending as her substitute. Jim, welcome to the meeting. It's good to see you here. So the first item on the agenda is, because you are attending as a substitute member of the committee, is to invite you to declare any interests, relevant interests that you have. Jim.
Thanks, Convener. I have no relevant interests other than a prior membership of NFUS Scotland.
Perfect. Thank you. The second item on the agenda is a decision on taking business in private. We have consideration of whether to take items 5, 6 and 7 in private. Item 5 is to consider the stakeholders' view on Scotland's guiding principles on the environment, statutory guidance and the recent Scottish Government report on the effectiveness of environmental governance regulations. Item 6 is to consider the evidence that we will hear under agenda item 3. And agenda 7 is to consider whether to seek approval for the appointment of an advisor. Are we all happy to take these items in private? We are happy, thank you. So agenda item 3 is an evidence session with Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow Limited following the company's latest quarterly update on the completion of MV Glen Sannox Hull 801 and MV, I think it's going to be called Glen Rosa, but as it hasn't been launched yet, I'm going to refer to it as Hull 802. And we'll examine the issues raised in Ferguson's Marine's quarterly update, as well as other issues affecting the delivery of the two vessels. I'm therefore pleased to welcome Andrew Miller, the chairman of Ferguson Marine Port Glasgow Limited, and David Tymon, the chief executive officer for Ferguson Marine. Thank you for joining us. And before we begin, David, I believe you want to make a brief opening statement.
Yes, thank you. Good morning, Convener. Thank you for the opportunity to come here today and to take questions you might have for me or our chairman, Andrew Miller. In the first few months after being appointed CEO of Ferguson in February 22, it became very clear to me that the design was far from complete for Glen Sannox, and much rework and redesign would be required. As context, less than 5% of cabling and only 20% of pipe spools had been installed at that time. Regrettably, we've encountered many more problems than I first imagined, and the amount of work to solve design clashes and errors of the past has been significant. However, we have now reached a stage where design is essentially complete, and from this, for the first time since I took office, a sense of control has been established over the scope of work for contractors, direct labour, Ferguson staff and associated materials. The principal contractors for Glen Sannox are on framework contracts, pricing for work as it arises by agreed labour rates, management charges and materials costed separately. As new design or redesign has been found, work scope has increased and contractor and Ferguson direct labour costs have risen month by month. I estimate that 50%, about 35 million, of the increases over the last 18 months on Glen Sannox have come directly from reworking the design, sometimes regrettably involving two or three iterations. Whilst the equipment on board Glen Sannox is not complex in its own right, the vessel is made complex by the need to fit a lot of systems and major components into restricted spaces. In this sense, these two ferries are far more complex than the Loch Seaforth, the largest vessel in the current fleet, and more complex than the four ferries being built in Turkey for Seamal. The design challenges have been very substantial, more complex than the Type 26, according to senior industry visitors I've had on site, and have been made far more difficult by the changes in designers and staff through the recovery twice from administration, nationalisation and the pandemic. However, we are making steady progress for trials to start in the new year with Glen Sannox, and then we will set out to prove the final design is fit for purpose and able to deliver the reliability expected and required by all involved. Having at last a final design and a clear work scope allows a more confident approach to Glen Rosa, and we've been able to get main contractors to offer fixed prices. Through this, we now have, perhaps for the first time, an opportunity to stay within the budget and contingencies. Overall, combining the £123 million incurred by FMEL between 2015 and 19, and the latest forecasts I've set out, Glen Sannox will have cost just over £200 million to complete, while Glen Rosa is expected to be £40 million less, reflecting the benefit of being the second ship. Within this, the overall cost of equipment and materials has doubled from about £50 million to £100 million, and £80 million will have been needed to cover the overheads of the shipyard. I'm pleased to advise that the work developing with BAE for the Type 26 programme has secured work for nearly 30 Ferguson staff, who otherwise would be faced with empty fabrication halls, and this work has also covered some of the overheads of the yard. This new work is an important aspect in securing staff morale on site, essential for maintaining the productivity we need for Glenrosa and Glensaddocks. Thank you.
Okay, there are a whole heap of questions, as you'd expect, David. I thought I'd start off with an easy one, is looking back when you first came and took over the construction, was it clear there were serious problems with the construction of the vessel at that stage? Were you clear from day one that you moved into the yard there were problems?
Not from day one. Within the first 3 months, I realised the design was incomplete. There were areas of clashes in routing of systems, and there was a complex problem ahead of me.
Okay, I mean, so when I think I visited the yard in 2018, there were pipes going up the lift shaft, which were clearly not going to allow the lift to operate. So you identified within 3 months. Why was this never picked up before? I don't understand why, after the yard was nationalised, that there appears to have been 2 years for the problem to be compounded. Do you think that's a fair assessment?
I think it is a fair assessment. I'm not sure why it took so long. Certainly between February 20, just before lockdown happened, the contracts were placed with ICE, the international contracting engineers, designers that we used. And they were given a fixed price contract with liquidated damages to produce the design by November 20. So during that lockdown period with the yard not working, they produced nearly 20,000 drawings formalising the design that had been developed by FMEL in using different designers in 2016 through to 19. And the Ferguson team on site was pretty thin at that time. And looking back, they barely had scope to catalogue the 20,000 drawings, let alone actually approve them. And so the issue of drawings over that period had a lot of circled holds, areas of questions, things to be clarified. And I think it then took another year to progress through that system by system.
Okay, so I'm unclear why 10 months after the yard was nationalised and we had a turnaround director in the yard, nothing's turned around, it's got worse. Can you explain that?
I can't explain it. I wasn't there at the time. I just, when I took office 18 months ago, it was clear that there were still large gaps in systems conflicts. Very little of the piping had been put into place. A lot of the cabling that still had to go. We'd only had about 10,000 metres of cabling in place in the ship in February 22, and we're now 310,000 metres of cabling. So all of that has gone in the last 18 months.
So we paid nearly £2 million to a turnaround director that didn't turn it round?
It's not for me to say on that.
Okay. So we'll go to the first questions then from Ash. I think you've got some questions, Ash.
Thank you, Convener. Yes. There's obviously been an announcement quite recently of further cost increases, and I think that will be of concern to many people who have obviously been watching the costs increase over the last period. So would you be able to outline for the committee what the reasons are behind this latest increase to costs?
If we look at the two ships separately, the largest increase is on Glensaddocks, and that's a product of finalising the design, reworking the design, regrettably doing some things twice or even three times as we've rerouted cables, rerouted pipework. One small example would be the hydraulic pipework in the front of the ship that is associated with opening the clamshell doors. That was all installed in mild steel and should have been stainless steel. So we had to take all of that out and redo it. That's one of many examples.
Okay, and you spoke in your opening statement about material cost rises. Is that due to different materials being required, or is that due to inflationary pressures that we're seeing at the moment?
I think it's a bit of both. The roughly 50 million budget in 2015 was for the main engines, generators, and a lot of that equipment was bought pretty much on budget in 2015, 16, 17. But the rest of the cabling materials, outfitting materials, pipework, that's had both scope and inflation aspects.
Okay. So can you detail what proactive steps you're taking to ensure that any further cost increases are being kept down to an absolute minimum?
I think the first action is we finished the design. So as I said in my opening statement, this is the first time I felt in control of the work scope. And if you know what you're actually still got to do, then you can price it. We've had open-ended contracts, time and materials, essentially, with all the contractors, and we couldn't get them to give fixed prices when we couldn't give a fixed scope. So the increases that we've faced over the last 18 months have been directly a result of asking contractors and the labour to do more work. With Glenrosa, a year ago, when we set out the 105 million budget, we had aspirations that we might be able to reduce the number of man hours, a stretch target, I think I called it in my letter a year ago. Inflation, increase in work scope has eroded that ambition for stretch, but the increases that I've announced last, at the end of September letter, is only 5 million from 105 to 110. And that's really linked to defining the scope and dealing with inflation aspects. So less increase forecast on Glenrosa. And again, as I said in my statement, I believe that we have a chance now of sticking to budget and within the contingencies on Glenrosa.
Okay. So you've got a current revised cost estimate, you've got a current predicted delivery date as well at the moment. How confident are you that you will meet both of those?
I'm more confident in the pricing than I am in the delivery dates because there's an uncertainty of the trials process. Once we start to run the engines, test the ship over the coming months in January, February particularly, that's when we'll know whether the design works, whether any vibration issues cause things to come loose. These are conventional things you test in the trials process with the ship. As I said in my opening statement, the ship in itself, the equipment is well proven. There's nothing there that is out of line with the market, but it's a complex ship in that systems are overlaid on itself, and the trials process is there to test whether it all works. If the trials go smoothly and the handover happens before the end of March for Glensanex, then I'm confident that we can stick to the programme with Glenrosa following on from that. If we get some delays in the trials from Glensanex, then it'll have a cascade effect onto Glenrosa.
Okay. And you said in your written update, and you also repeated again in your opening statement, that the design work is now largely complete. So you've also, though, got a contingency of 30 million, and that's at this stage of the project. So if the design work is complete, why the need for the 30 million contingency?
The contingency is in two parts, maximum 12 million on Glensanex, 18 on Glenrosa. I set that out in the letter on the end of September to this committee. The Glensanex contingency is linked to trying to put numbers on possible things that might come out of trials. Do we need to replace things? Do we need to buy new equipment? Have we got delay costs? Have we got to rent quayside space for running the trials? That the 12 million is allowed for those sort of aspects. On Glenrosa, the 18 million, I put a range of between 3 and 18. And we're in the process, as I said, of trying to secure fixed price contracts with the contractors. And the electrical contract and the piping contract is nearly 50% of the subcontract costs on Glenrosa. And we're in negotiations at the moment. And I've got some contingency within the 18 million is anticipating that to be able to transfer risk to the contractors and get them to go to fixed price, I may have to negotiate a little bit on the pricing. So some of the 18 million is allowing for negotiations that may happen. The other parts of the 18 million are for potential delay costs if we get a cascade effect from trials from Glensannox.
Okay, thank you, Convener.
Okay, I think the next questions come from Monica.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to our panel. In your most recent written update, you've highlighted the effects of the COVID lockdowns on construction progress. But in previous updates, for example, July 2021, it was highlighted how effectively the yard dealt with COVID. So I wondered if you can perhaps advise what proportion of the six-year delay is attributable to COVID and to those lockdown periods?
It's very hard for me to do that looking back. I wasn't there at the time. I think it was 5 or 6 million was the claim for COVID impact made in 21 before my time. That seems to me to be a small sum for the lockdown effect of the yard for 6-9 months. In particular, the impact, as I mentioned earlier, about the drawings being produced by ICE at that time and a fairly thin engineering team trying to cope with that. You imagine trying to get technical approval of drawings with people working remotely, in some cases working from the Outer Hebrides. One of the engineers for CMAL was involved trying to approve technical drawings working on a dial-up line on his laptop. The embedded costs of that period, I think, were far more than the 5 or 6 million. And therefore the cascade time impact would be more as well.
So does that mean, in your view, that the impact of COVID has previously been underestimated?
Personal opinion, yes.
Okay. You made an interesting point there about remote working and in terms of having a negative impact. But others may say that shipbuilding is an international industry and, you know, it's quite established that, you know, contractors, people are working around the globe and able to communicate effectively. Is that something that you would recognise and agree with?
I think it's a mixture. There are some benefits of working remotely in some areas. Procurement teams can work remotely. The ICE design contractors, they're based in Romania. We've got pretty good dial-up lines with them and can work remotely at a distance. I think when you're physically putting the ship together and the engineering team need to walk the corridors, walk through the engineering spaces, you have to be on site. So remote working can work, but when you're putting a ship together, you've got to be on site seeing the work done.
Okay, thank you. And just there's been reference to a shortfall of skilled labour and that also contributing to delays. I wonder if you can expand on that in terms of the sort of picture or spread of skills previously and your view of that now.
I think when this contract was placed in 2015, Ferguson was recovering from administration and had reduced down to only 70 staff. There were about 20 salaried staff within that, 50 were the trade skills. And that was a pretty thin team to start this project with. They ramped up to about 200 within the first year. We're now running at about 320. But within the trade skills we have, we have 60 welders and platers with an age profile, most of them within 5 years of retirement. And then at the other end of the spectrum, we've got 60 apprentices, all under 25. And then a big gap in the middle. So the skills mix in the yard is quite challenging if I look 5 years ahead. How do we fill that retirement? How do we train people up? How do we recruit people in the middle age groups to come in and build a more sustainable team for the future?
Indeed, and you've got a plan in place for that. Mm. Okay. In terms of also looking at your most recent written update, it mentions that designers were set, and this is a quote from the letter, an impossible timeline and deliverables. So I wonder if you can help us understand who set the timeline, why do you think it was impossible, and what effects does this have ultimately on costs and delivery?
I mentioned it just after my opening statement that 20,000 drawings were produced in a 9-month period between February and November 20 during lockdown period and early pandemic issues. It would have been my predecessor who placed that contract in February 20. Talking with the CEO of the design company, he said they agreed to a fixed price with liquidated damages if they didn't deliver by November. But in doing that, they produced nearly 20,000 drawings with comments and markups on them without a team at Ferguson able to receive them properly, barely catalogue them, as I mentioned earlier, certainly not technically check them. So I think that task was unwise to set out with that deadline, with that fixed price. It may have seemed logical at the time, getting a nice fixed price from the design contractor, but it embedded a lot of questions all over the drawings that were produced, and it took a lot of time to then settle those out.
Thank you for that. I suppose just final question from me is, you know, what's your understanding of the role that ministers played in setting those deadlines or reviewing those deadlines?
I'm not aware of the ministerial roles in the past. I know the relationships I've had over the last 18 months.
Okay. Thank you, Convener.
Sorry, you left that answer hanging. You said you know the relationship you've had in the last 18 months. You better tell us, because we don't.
Sorry, my apologies. I've had regular meetings with, first of all, Ms. Forbes, then Mr. Swinney, Deputy First Minister, and then subsequently with Neil Gray over the last few months. Most of the reporting is via the sponsoring team on a weekly and monthly basis.
So pretty hands-on is what you're saying?
With the sponsor team, yes.
Okay, thank you. I think the Deputy Convener wanted to come in with some questions. Ben.
Thank you, Convener. Thanks for being here. Just following up on the questions that colleagues have asked, there are a number of other projects that have had challenges through even recent history, including this building that we're in now, where, as my understanding, the design wasn't complete before the project was initiated. I mean, how much of a problem has that been throughout the process of these two vessels? If the design had been largely complete, to use your words, at a much earlier stage, would that have had a really significant positive impact compared to where we are now?
Definitely, yes, it would have had a big impact. It doesn't matter whether you're trying to put a new kitchen in your house or build a building like this. If you know what you're asking the contractors to do on day one, you get a clearer price and you get a clearer program. With a complex vessel like this, having a lot of uncertainty in the design, it led to mistakes, to rework and to increase costs. There's no doubt about it in my mind that the design was not robust enough when steelwork was started a long time ago.
And is there anything further you would want to relay to us as to why there was that position in terms of the design when works were initiated?
I can only look back with hindsight. Reading the KC report that was published last week, it highlighted again that the statement of technical requirements was originally drafted for a 200-metre vessel, and then it was reduced down to the 100-metre vessels that we're now building. That implies that the specification was larger than it perhaps it needed to be. The multi-port operation that was in the original specification certainly led to a complex ship with quite a lot of redundancy. You can, for example, the switching between the two main engines, you can switch power from one engine to both propeller shafts, and you can run both engines, both propellers from one engine, swap it over, run it from the other side. That level of, I think there's 16 different modes in the propulsion system alone. and we have a complex ship management system that allows you to run all of those options from the bridge or from the main switchboard room. That level of sophistication for this ship has driven the design complexities.
And looking forward, with the design now largely complete, are there areas of the design that concern you at this juncture that still need to be complete, or are you satisfied that those remaining areas that require to be fully decided are going to be able to be considered and signed off in a timeous manner?
Well, we're being asked to build the second ship the same as the first one with minor improvements. So where we can route cables a little more efficiently, route piping a little more efficiently, we're doing that in the design planning. The other thing that I've spent quite a bit of effort on with the designers is to making sure that we've captured all of the learning from Glen Sannox, and in the work packs that are typically a 40-hour work pack would be issued to a supervisor in a job, that he's got one drawing. He hasn't got to refer to 10. He hasn't got a mixture of modification sheets, marked up drawings as we've changed things from Glen Sannox. So I hope that as we plan the programme and start the work, we've got clear definition of what we're trying to do.
Thank you.
I hope they're all numbered correctly. And I think on the original specification, there were passenger cabins dictated as well, which were never built. Jim, you want to come in on it?
This is just a kind of a follow-up to Ben's question. And I'm new to this committee, so if I'm asking stuff that's been asked previously, then, you know, you can tell me. You talked earlier on, Mr. Tengman, about mild steel being used in the hydraulic shell clamp doors when it should have been stainless steel. That seems like a fairly basic error to have made. And if you're building a house, you know the weight of lintel that you're going to put in, if you're going to hold up a window or you're going to hold up a garage door. Who's responsible for making those kind of decisions and implementing those kind of costly mistakes?
Sorry, let me just clarify. It was the hydraulic pipe work for the control systems, not the structural steel that I was talking about.
Understand that it's hydraulics.
The specification came out of our design team, and it was wrongly specified. So somebody had written down mild steel, had the piping built, had it installed, and then when we checked through that it's in a seawater environment, it's a weather-tight environment rather than a watertight environment inside the clamshell doors, and has to be in stainless steel. Simple error, missed. We've had galvanised pipe used in areas where it shouldn't have been used, and had to change that as well. We've had lots of mistakes.
That was my next question you've just answered. Has there been lots of these kinds of mistakes?
Unfortunately, yes.
Thanks, Kevin.
Okay. Douglas, I think you've got some questions, and I think you've got... I'd like to get Mark in the middle of some of the questions, so if we can, you can kick off, start off.
OK, thanks, Camilla. Just back to your first point you made right at the start, that you said that these ferries are more complex than a Type 26 frigate. Now, listening on to that, that just sounds absolutely incredible. How on earth did we get into that sort of situation?
I honestly don't know, because the specification was produced a long time ago and before I got involved. And I just reiterate that they're more complex in the sense of trying to put a lot into a small space. That's the challenge, rather than necessarily the individual components. Obviously, you have a lot more sophisticated systems on the Type 26 frigate. But if you think about a ferry, it's a U-shape around which you around the car deck. And you have to squeeze everything into the side casings and below the card deck. That's the fundamental engineering challenge of a ferry.
And if it's so complex, what does that mean for going forward in terms of the maintenance of these vessels going, you know, for the lifespan of them? Does that mean it's going to be a lot more expensive to keep them running?
I don't know, is the answer. As I said in my opening statement, the individual components, the choice of engines, choice of generators, choice of the shipyard ship management system, they're all well-proven technologies, so they should be reliable. The complexity could be that it takes 5 hours to strip down a pump rather than 2 hours because you've got restricted access and you have to take a few other things apart before you can get to the job in hand. If this ship proves to be reliable, all it could mean is a annual three-week dry docking becomes a four-week dry docking, perhaps. I could imagine it being that sort of burden on maintenance rather than anything more significant.
But when you talk about the complexity of the engine management system, is that not going to potentially provide issues going forward that, you know, that they are maybe over-complex for what we actually needed?
The Praxis system that's been installed on the ship for ship management is well proven, and it's been developed to actually reduce maintenance issues because it interconnects so well and gives the chief engineer and the captain so much more information available at his desktop rather than physically having to go and look at things. So the data management should be reliable, and it should be quite a sophisticated ship to operate.
And staying on the pricing, you know, we had been told that, you know, the $97 million original contract price was understated, and it's, you know, it should have been a lot more. But considering that FML were the most expensive when it came to bidding, how could that be?
It's long before my time. We're going back 9 years to that bidding process in 2015, 8-9 years. When I look at the specification and price it with the benefit of hindsight, I think in one of my letters I estimated that these were ships that should be 70 million each in the marketplace, 140 rather than 97. That was, I think I put that figure to the Public Audit Committee last December. How other competitors would have priced lower than that, I don't know.
But even that 70 figure, that's still a lot less than 200 and 160, and it seems like we've, instead of building two vessels, we've actually built a gravy train instead, because that's a huge amount of money. So what's happened to that extra, you know, 220 million? Has that all gone to contractors? Has it gone to things like, you know, the wrong type of equipment that's put in and they have to come out and be scrapped? Where's that money gone?
There's been some scrapping of pipework and other equipment that's been taken out. You'll remember that in February 22 we took out, I think, 20,000 metres of legacy cables and had to scrap that. If you take the components of the 97 million original pricing, there was about 70 million for contractors and materials, and from what I've been able to see, I think 50 million of that was equipment and materials that has become 100. That's through inflation, buying some things twice, so that component has gone from 50 to 100. There was only about 10 million, 12 million in that original 97 for overhead contribution for the shipyard. The ferries were meant to be partially contributing to the yard for a period of about 4 years. In the figures of the 130 and 110 for the two ships now, if you add together the FML 123 million, there's about 80 million of overhead recovery for the shipyard over 8 years, 8-9 years will have been in the budget. So overhead contribution has one significant part of the increase, and the rest is increased in direct labour costs and subcontractor costs.
But if you were building that again, it would be a lot less. I think that's what you said earlier.
Yeah. So overall, external spend in the 360 total, that's the 240 from FMPG and 123 from FML. There is more than 200 is external spend, and the rest is internal overheads and labour at Ferguson.
Moving on to the dual fuel aspect of it, obviously that's added a lot of complexity to this project. But one of the unsuccessful bidders, or the Oran 802, have since delivered four dual fuel vessels of roughly a similar size, but a lot less money. Have you learnt anything from them? Are you in communication with them? How were they able to deliver dual fuel, but we haven't been able to?
I haven't been in touch with the others. The complexity of the LNG system is the space it takes up. There is a very large cylindrical tank in the middle of the ship that stores the very low temperature LNG in liquid form. And then there's a sophisticated heating system that turns that into the gas that is then used on the engines as a substitute for the marine diesel. As a system, that's not complex. There's just one pipe, albeit low-temperature steel pipe, for loading low-temperature liquid once a week, once a month, when you have to fill the tank. Then you purge that line, close it off, and you have liquid in the big cylinder tank in the ship. That turns into a gas, and you run the engines. That's well-proven technology. It's out there on many, many ships all over the world. LNG is well-proven. The only complexity for this ship really is we haven't commissioned an LNG ship in the UK before, so they've previously been built elsewhere, and we're going to go through that learning of the final commissioning of that system in the coming months. And it's the space impact. That tank takes up a lot of space in the ship.
Do you think the vessels will ever run on LNG? Because obviously initially they're not going to, are they?
We're going to hand them over with dual fuel capability. So yes, CalMac will be able to run them on both fuels from handover. How they choose to operate them, that's their decision.
And I guess it's up to them. Part of the commissioning process will be running on LNG as well, I would imagine.
Yes.
You'd have to prove it works.
We'll prove the whole ship with the diesel system first, and then commission the LNG, and then run the engines switching between the two fuels.
Okay. Thanks, Camino.
Okay, I'm going to go backwards slightly on some overhead costs. I think, Mark, you wanted to come in, and Jim Fairley would like to come in as well. So, Mark, for you first.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. If I could go back to overhead recovery, I think you were saying in your letter to the committee that some of the overheads for the yard will be covered by other business. Can you describe to me what that other business is, and has that other business come in since nationalisation?
Yes, it's a business I secured with BAE to be a subcontractor for the Type 26 programme. It's only starting slowly. We have about £2 million worth of work to build three small units for Type 26 number 3 that's currently in build in Govan. That's kept about 30 people busy in the fabrication hall. That's been running for, we started that in July, and it's due to complete before Christmas. There's an invitation to tender out for a lot more work for the Type 26 programme, and we're bidding for that. Not quite sure what we'll secure for next year, but that could soak up about 30 to 40% of the yard capacity from spring onwards, which is important for keeping people busy. It also would then, we would do an overhead allocation proportionately to the ferries and the other work.
Thanks for that. And have the difficulties with 801, 802 affected you as a business? Like, would you have expected to have more work coming in, or is the work on the frigates what you would expect right now?
We chose deliberately to position for the work with the frigates. We've also submitted quotes to Babcock for the Type 31 programme over at Rosyth, and we've looked at a number of other small projects, steelwork fabrication, bridges, some link spans, small work like that. But frankly, until very recently, all of the workforce was fully occupied on the ferries.
Okay, so you don't see any reputational damage?
I think the constant media coverage has been difficult. Certainly getting BAE to place work with us is a morale boost and an indication that they trust us. We need more of that.
Okay, back to you, Convener.
Thanks very much, Mark. Jim, you wanted to come in with a question.
It was very much along those same lines. I was going to ask you how long the BAE contract was for and how many people that would keep employed. And just looking forward to the longer term, you know, what is the long-term prospects for keeping the yard open and keeping these people employed?
The BAE Type 26 work, they're currently trying to find a supplier to do the bow blocks for ships 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8. That's between 80 and 100 million of work over perhaps 5 years. There's possibly further work to come from the 26 programme after that. So that's a very significant pipeline of work. If we don't get the bow block contracts, then there are also more units, smaller units, very similar to the three that we're making at the moment, and there could be, you know, 10 or 12 units per year for that ship programme over the next 5 years. One way or another, we're strategically trying to position ourselves to be a key subcontractor for that Type 26 programme. That could take up maybe 100 people in the keep the fabrication halls busy. The work is very suitable for Ferguson, being only 15 miles downriver from Govan. It's easy to transport the finished units up by barge upriver to the finished shipyard in Govan. And it's free issue materials and it's free issue engineering. So our job is a fabricator. And that is simple, repeatable work that we can do well to a good quality. And we're getting some very good feedback at the moment for the work we're doing with the, what's called the pilot project. That doesn't keep the yard busy completely after Glen Rosa is finished. We need something else. And I've set out both to the board and to our sponsor team in SG and ministers that for the yard to recover, we need repeatable work. We need to get into a drumbeat of something that we can do consistently within our capabilities, using the facilities as they're currently built. So we're not trying to do something that stretches the facilities or stretches the team. And the obvious program to complement the BAE work is the small ferry replacement program, the seven small ferries. They're 50 metres, they're simple electric propulsion, big plug-in battery bank switchboards, electric motors. We could contract with a specialist supplier for all of that plug-in electrical pack and would build the steelwork together. We'd build it in 6 or 7 units. We know we can do that. Seamail know we can do that. And if we could get the small ferry programme and the pipeline of work from the Type 26 programme, then we have a sustainable 5-year vision ahead of us.
That's just sparked another question. Is it the design part of this project that has been the problem rather than the implementation of it?
It's certainly one of the major issues. I think the implementation has been stop-start, hasn't helped. Contract...
Design?
Yeah. Fundamentally, design is the issue.
So when you talked about the BAE contract, the BAE contract, you're saying that that's just repetitive yard work. Are you trying to avoid the design side of things? Do you not have the capability for the design as well as the fabrication?
I'm not trying to avoid it. But as a strategic choice, we've got to restore our reputation. We've got to have a new chapter in the future of the yard. And if we choose wisely the right type of work, then we'll win back our reputation. So we have a weak design team, a weak design capability. Choosing the small ferry program, which is a relatively simple package that's repeatable, working with BAE as a subcontractor with their design and their assembly procedures and routines, that's a stable environment that I think we can do well.
Thank you.
Just on the design, David, presumably the designs were signed off by Seamail as and when they came up as the sponsor for the vessels. So why didn't they pick up all these design problems that you're saying? I mean, are they working with you at the moment?
We have a team of Seamail people on site and have had for years, right through the contract, as the owner's representatives. Firstly, as the client with the FMEL contract, and then on behalf of Scottish ministers, who is our client now for the last few years, they are regularly looking at the ship, walking the ship, coming up with what are called owner's observation reports, OORs, and we've had a list as I think 600, 700 areas that they've identified that need design improvement, and we gradually work through them.
I'm totally confused. So you've got Seamail signing off the designs, and the designs are a problem, and you're saying that they're not signed off. Seamail are also signing off the payments and signed off £82 million of £97 million contract when only half a boat was constructed. Well, what's going on? I don't understand. Where does the buck stop? Because you're saying it's not the it's designs. CMAL have signed the designs off. Somewhere between the two of you, I'm confused. Who is carrying the can?
There are four stages of design: concept, basic, detailed, and then production. So the concept and basic design are produced by the specifying client, so the combination of CalMac and CMAL back to 2014-2015. When you go to contract, and Ferguson Marine Engineering, FMEL, took on the contract, they take design accountability and the buck should stop with them to deliver within their contract price. Their arguments going back in the past, as much as I've been able to read, were saying the design specification wasn't complete and they requested variations and had a large claim in 2019. I think FMEL by that time were forecasting that the cost had doubled from 97 to 197, and 83, as you said, was paid out. 45 million loan was also written off and used to cover the difference between the 83 and the 123. The company then went into administration in 2019 through the failure of that agreement. Then Scottish ministers take on the contract, nationalise the shipyard. The accountability is with me and the management team and my predecessor. And CMAL are just the observers on, are we building it to the specification?
So all the problems with design that you're facing now fall back to your predecessor. Is that what you're saying?
I think a fair amount fall back to the Ferguson FMEL team in the early stages, proceeding to build an empty ship without advanced outfitting before we put modules together. And then that was further exacerbated by the contract placed with ICE in 2020.
Okay, I don't want to cover old ground, but I absolutely know for a fact that if I was representing a client and I signed off £82 million worth of work and only got £30 million, I'd probably be for the high jump. Maybe it's different as being a surveyor or an ex-surveyor than it is being building boats, but somehow I doubt it. Jim, did you want to come back in?
Thank you.
Okay, Douglas, you have a further question.
Thank you, Convener. I just want to come in for a point of clarity. So you spoke about the costs of the vessels being 200 and 160. Does that include the pre-nationalisation costs, or does it include other, that you know, you mentioned the loan to the yard as well? Is that the costs for everything that the government's paid towards Ferguson's and for those two vessels?
Yes. In the 123 incurred cost to date that is in the FMEL documents that I've seen dating back to June 19 pre-administration, they break that 123 down into 75 for Glen Sannox and 48 for Glen Rosa. Again, just to go back to Convener, to your comments a moment ago, there was about 40 million of fixed equipment bought within that 83. So it wasn't just the steelwork, there was a lot of equipment bought. But yes, the 123 plus the 130 plus the 110 adds up to the 360.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, I'm going to now just ask one or two questions as far as one of the reasons for the delay that you've given. David, could you just confirm to me, who is it within your operation that speaks to the MCA regarding approvals? Is that you, or is there somebody there?
It's a combination. I have been involved personally. Within the first 3 months, as I mentioned earlier, I realised that there were design gaps, one of which was an MCA issue. I was shown drawings dating back to 2016-17 that had red line marks from the MCA highlighting that cargo rules had been used for some of the crew spaces and highlighting that there were non-compliance issues on stair widths and other aspects. So in June the 15th, was the earliest I could get the MCA to come and see me, but the regional director, the principal surveyor from the Glasgow office and the technical manager came for a meeting with me and two of my senior management engineering director and compliance director, and we went through the issues in June saying, okay, the drawings clearly show that the design produced years ago has structural limitations on escape shafts, on stairwells up from the car deck to the passenger decks, and has some assumptions on the routing and corridor widths of passengers and their evacuation from, let's say, the observation lounge deck 6 through crew spaces to get to the muster stations on deck 5. So we had a fairly lengthy conversation 18 months ago, and I said my key question to them was, are there any red line issues that we're not going to be able to solve, because this is high on my radar, having evacuation routes, having escape routes identified and designed is normally one of the first things you would do with a ship, and that should have been sorted out in long ago, 2015-16. The surveyors in that meeting assured me that we would find a solution, that they used the word equivalence and compliance rather than exemptions. And the MCA never acts as a consultancy. It won't give you advice on how to solve a problem. You have to come up with the answers yourself. But the output of that conversation was that we should do some 3D computer modelling for evacuation routes, and we employed Lloyd's Register of Shipping to use their sophisticated modelling to do that, and to show that we could get rule compliance, which is get everybody on the ship into the muster stations and off down through the slides within an hour is the allowed time, maximum time. The modelling showed that we could get everybody out in 29 minutes. And so that led to a feeling of, OK, we're going to get compliance, we're going to get equivalence. It's called a 1261 form that gives you an exemption or equivalence approval. And the first 1261 form was issued in November 22. And that led to, after we've done the evacuation modelling, and that led to the submissions down to head office in January this year, 23. But it wasn't until April 23 when we realised that head office had a more strict approach to application of rules, decisions that had been made a long time ago, the modelling, and we had to do some rethinking between April and June. I've been fairly closely involved with it over the last few months.
So is the compliance director the same person that has run through the whole project, or did the compliance director change when it came to the MCA?
He was actually an original employee of FML and transferred to Peter Cross in nationalisation. He was the one who highlighted to me that the early drawings from 2017. But we were perhaps overconfident that we were going to get all these exemptions based on the modelling and the conversations last year. And it was a bit of a surprise that we had to do the design changes that we've done over the last few months.
So, I wrote to you, I think, earlier, when did I write to you? I wrote to you in August asking about when you approached the MCA regarding these escape hatches and routes. And the first one, the 1261 application, you said was put in July of this year.
Sorry.
But you're telling me that you put it in July... and that was for just one escape route, when you actually identified the problem 2 years ago, nearly 2 years ago.
There were separate issues, so I'm sorry if my letter to you wasn't clear, but the exemption 1261 that was issued in November 22 related to the main stairwells that come up through the casing from the car deck. So as you park your car, get out and walk up the stairs either side into the passenger areas, those stairwells, the tread width is 800 millimetres and it should be 900 millimetres. Given that you come up single file and the modelling allows for a person to be roughly 500 millimetres wide, actually the fact that it was 100 or 800 or 900 was deemed to be not a serious issue because there was plenty of width for the hand railing and an access for staff through there. That 1261 was issued for both ships in November 22. The application that we did in July this year was realising that the assumptions that we'd made in the modelling that passengers, particularly on deck 6 in the forward area observation lounge, there's only a single staircase down from there to the evacuation areas on deck 5. And the only alternative to that is to go through the crew spaces, through the crew cabins and corridors, and to the two staircases at the rear of deck six. That was deemed to be unacceptable with the latest update we got in April and May. And as I said earlier, the MCA don't give you a solution to that. They just say it's not accepted. You can't rely on passengers going out through crew spaces. And
I understand that, and I understand that the revisions 4 and 5 that you're talking about were done in November last year, but if you look at revisions 7, 8 and 9, which are the ones you're on, I suspect, at the moment, they were only submitted in July of this year. Now, we've had a letter from the MCA, David, which is quite clear, saying exactly what you've just said. It's not up to them to design the problem, design out the problem. It's for you to work with them. And they go on to say that the regulations that they are referring to have been extant and in force since 2009. In fact, they say there were amendments, but they made no difference, and therefore they are unclear why you are citing this as a problem, because they're saying they've been fully consistent with the requirements since 2009. So there seems to be some discrepancy. The MCA say it's your fault, and you're saying it's the MCA's fault because they're interpreting a different way. Now, you both can't be right. One of you's got to be wrong.
The meeting I had with the local surveyors from the Glasgow office and the regional director last June 22, and the modelling we did after that, we were fully aware that we'd made some assumptions, or Ferguson FMEL had, and Holder Marine back in 2015-16, had made some assumptions that the cargo rules could be used for the crew areas, and the ship had been designed with that in mind. And again, just for the benefit of the committee, to put that into context, if you've got professional crew, you assume that they're not going to panic the same way that passengers might, and so you're allowed narrower doorways and narrower corridors for circulation within the crew spaces. The ship was designed with those assumptions in mind, and those conversations on how we would get approval for the ship have been going on with the local office, and finally overruled by the head office, who wrote to you that letter I saw last night, in April this year. So there was a disconnect between the local conversations we were having with the MCA here in Glasgow and the final decisions from the head office in Southampton.
Really? So you are putting this down between... I mean, the committee will have to, I would suggest, consider that further, because you're saying that it's a discrepancy in somebody else's offices, whereas they are quite clearly saying that it's actually you.
Well, the responsibility has to rest with Ferguson for, firstly, producing a design with the wrong assumptions, as the MCA very clearly set out. There are precedents of other ships out there with cargo spaces on ferries being, crew spaces being designed for narrower corridors compared with the passenger spaces. That is not allowed anymore. I know that the principal surveyor from the Glasgow office flew out to Turkey to look at the four ships that Seamal have had in build there to check that there was no issue with those ships after this clarification was issued in April. We have come up with a solution of producing extra staircases so that the passengers don't have to go through the crew areas. And we've also bought 17 new doors to make them wider in the crew spaces to get as close to compliance as we can there. So those areas, the staircases and the extra doors, have cost about £1 million of work to do that design, buying the equipment and the disruption costs of that. We have come up with a solution. We've found a compliance solution, and yes, it's Ferguson's responsibility to get that right, and we didn't get it right in the past.
But is it not then disingenuous to put it down to, or put it in the report that you gave to the Parliament, that this was one of the reasons for the delay, when this delay should have been identified or was identified over 18 months ago? If you'd started addressing it 18 months ago, I would humbly suggest that the delay might not have existed.
Well, I think there's two aspects. One, it hasn't caused a delay to the handover. We've been able to come up with a solution. The staircases are in place. They're being finished off now. We're waiting for the doors to be delivered. They're due in December. They will be fitted within the trials period. The extension to the time that I've now put into the end of September letter is mainly down to electrical and piping work and finishing off the rest of the ship. We've been able to cope with the MCA changes that we've had to make within the programme. Yes, with hindsight in June, when I wrote to you June and August, I believed that these were going to cause a risk to the delay to the ship. But as I clarified in the letter at the end of September, we've been able to cope with the escape route changes within the programme, and the programme has slipped for other reasons.
Okay, David, I mean, what concerns me is, as clearly says in the MCA letter, there has been no reassessment of the application of the regulations. They have not changed. So you're saying that they have changed and that they're saying that it's not. So it's your word against them.
We shouldn't get into that position. The local conversations we've been having on ship, in the shipyard, with the local surveyors led us to believe that we were going to get exemptions on the, without having to change the doors in the crew space, without having to put new staircases in. As I said a moment ago, maybe we were overconfident in those assumptions and the conversation with the local surveyor, and it's been very clearly, finally clarified by the letter last night.
Yeah, it's a fairly damning letter. Just so I can understand before we move on, you also said in your I should offer the committee, does anyone want to come in on the MCA letters before I ask a slightly different question? Douglas.
If I may, actually, in terms of the MCA letter, because, you know, when we asked the Cabinet Secretary when he was aware of issues with the MCA, he said the 28th of June would set out requirements for Ferguson Marine to install additional escapes in the upper deck areas. What I can't understand is 2 days later, we had an update from yourself that only has a fleeting mention of MCA, not any mention of additional stairways having to be installed. Why was the committee not told at that opportunity that additional staircases had to be installed? Because the Cabinet Secretary knew 2 days before.
It was still work in progress, and we hadn't got a clear solution agreed with the MCA, and I'm not sure why we didn't. I couldn't give you clear information at that time.
But the Cabinet Secretary was given clear information. He was given clear information. Additional escapees in the upper deck areas had to be installed. So surely, if he was told 2 days earlier, we should have been told during the update on the 30th of June.
We didn't get approval for the stairwell design and the extra doors until end of August. So we knew that we were going to have to design some solutions, but I didn't have a fixed solution at that time.
But as a committee, we should have been told, just the same way as the Cabinet Secretary was told 2 days before, of the issues that was looming. I think that would have just been courtesy to this committee. I'll leave it there, Camilla.
Andrew, can I just ask, from the board's point of view, you're aware of all of these delays. Are you comfortable that assumptions were made which proved at the end of the day not to be valid assumptions?
Yeah, we have. I've been chair for the last 10 months. And, we've had some issues in terms of, competency at the board level that we're sort of sorting out. People aren't keen to do second terms, as it were, which is a bit of a disappointment, but I fully understand. And I spent the last week, two full days, going through applications and interviewing people for the board roles. The board are across the issues that we've actually spoken about today. It is a bit messy. It's like trying to catch a bus when the bus is running and jump on it and make sure you don't break your leg. But the board are capable and competent in this area. And we do have two board members who have extensive shipbuilding. One from BAE is a sort of marine architect, and another board of directors who used to work on the Clyde in the past. So there's nothing that's come up today that is a surprise to me personally.
Okay. David, just before we move on to some other questions from other members, could you just clarify, you said that these additional fire escape routes and requirements to be met, known requirements to be met, would reduce the passenger carrying capacity from 1,000, I think it was, to the 800s. What effect is it on lorries and cars? Is there a reduction in lorries and cars?
No. The carrying capacity, target carrying capacity for lorries and cars remains the same. And I should clarify that our contract was 960 passengers, although the target was 1,000, the contract was signed at 960. The revised 1261 approvals that we've had with the MCA for the stairwells and doors allows a maximum of 929, so only a drop of 31. But we can only achieve that 929 by using some bench seating and higher density of seating in some of the areas that CMAL and CalMAC between them have decided they would rather maintain the quality of seating and reduce the headcount down to, I think the figure is 852 is in discussion at the moment. It's their choice whether we maximise to the allowable 929 or reduce to 852. But I understand, you'd need to ask them more details, but I understand there's less than a month where numbers are likely to be above 100. 800.
Indeed, which is why I think the REC committee questioned why they were asking for a ferry to be built with 1,000 seats on it. But my question to you was that still exactly the same number of cars, still exactly the same number of lorries.
In the contract we have loading conditions, permutations of lorries and cars that we have to verify. The inclining test that we'll do at the end of January to verify the vertical centre of gravity of the ship as built, that'll be the final refinement of the load carrying capacity, and we hope to prove that we meet target in January.
And the ferry as built will still meet the deadweight requirements in the original contract and the speed requirements in the original contract?
Yes, I'm assured that we've got more than enough power to hit the 16.5 knot speed requirement, although I understand the operating speed's going to be around 14 knots from information from CalMAC. The dead weight, I think, is just under 900 tonnes is the carrying capacity in the contract.
OK, so it will meet the original contract?
Subject to the inclining and all the trials going right, yes, I hope to meet the contract.
OK. Douglas, I think you've got some further questions.
Yes, it's really around that 1261 that was rejected back in November 22. So when would have CMAL been notified of that, and when would have Transport Scotland been notified that 1261 application had been rejected?
Sorry, could I clarify? It wasn't rejected in November 21. November 22 was the first 1261 that was issued, confirming that the 800 millimetre wide stairs in the casings was acceptable. We submitted the rest of the evacuation modelling finally at the beginning of this year, and that was first we heard of that wasn't going to be accepted was April this year, and at that time we started discussions with CMAL as well, because as we came up with solutions for the extra stairwells and the doors changes, we wanted to involve them in how we came up with solutions.
Okay, so it would have just been after April that you received that rejection of that document, and then you would have informed CMAL and Transport Scotland at that time then?
CMAL first, because we have regular meetings with CMAL. Transport Scotland, we only meet once a month.
And we've heard in the past that there's weekly meetings take place between Ferguson and Scottish Government officials. So would have it been discussed at those meetings as well?
The monthly meeting was a main progress meeting, but more recently, over the last few months, we've been meeting on a weekly basis. It's called the handover planning team. So we're trying to work on the logistics of handing over Glen Sannox to CalMAC. The weekly meeting involves Transport Scotland, CalMAC, CMAL, SG and ourselves.
And at those weekly meetings, would this 1261 process been discussed during those meetings?
Yes.
So the government would have known in April that there was an issue around the stairwells because the 1261.
The weekly meetings weren't running in April. They only started from, I think, July or August onwards. The monthly meetings, I think the first monthly meeting that I advised SG was towards the end of May.
Okay. So end of May, Scottish Government would have known that there was an issue on the escape plan and the 1261. So I guess I'm just trying to work out why maybe like this committee weren't aware of it till much later, and it seemed to be that the Cabinet Secretary wasn't aware of it till much later as well. But it would have been discussed at those meetings. So I guess that's maybe a question for us, Convener, that we have to try and work out why that wasn't fed back to the Cabinet Secretary during those meetings, if it was discussed at the meetings that we've heard about at the end of May.
I have to clarify the end of May, maybe it was June, but the process we went through, we decided that we would make it broadly public when we knew what the solution was. At the time, we had a problem and we didn't have a solution. We hadn't worked out how to fit the staircases and how to solve the doors. And were we going to have a bigger problem, or could we come up with a solution with staircases? So we made the sponsoring team aware that we were in discussions trying to find solutions, and we didn't get a solution and agreed until the end of August. And during that period, I wasn't aware of how the sponsoring team were reporting to the Cabinet Secretary and Ministers. That's a disconnect. I'm reporting to the sponsoring team.
No, of course, but it's useful for us to know that Scottish Government officials were aware in May. Thank you.
Okay, Graham, welcome to the committee, and your questions are now.
Thanks very much, Convener, and thanks for allowing me some time to ask a couple of questions. I think it would be worthwhile if I just follow up on some of what's been said already. So to summarise what you've been saying, I mean, you've been building a vessel that's more complex than a Type 26. It doesn't meet or hasn't been meeting safety regulations. According to Mr. Miller, people are fleeing the board. You could say it's like rat. Well, people have left the board.
Attracting quality people to the board has been significantly challenging.
So, now, can you tell me, Mr. Tideman, my understanding is that your Director of Compliance left his post last month. Is that correct?
2 months ago, I think.
Yes. Okay. Was he being blamed for this MCA issue?
No, not personally. He wanted to set up as an independent consultant, and he chose to go and set himself up that way a couple of months ago. The lead on design responsibility sits with the engineering team.
What impact will him leaving have on the completion of all the ship's documentation, including class society documents?
Very little. We have the engineering team and the quality team are on top of the documentation and the closeout.
And are you concerned at all that there are other areas of non-compliance on the ship?
No. As I said, I called the MCA in for a meeting 18 months ago to ask them that question of, could they please put on the table anything that was going to cause me a problem? I thought we were on the right track with the MCA approvals from that meeting in June 22. It was a surprise in April this year to see a change of direction, which we've fortunately been able to solve. I had a similar meeting with the senior people from Lloyd's Register and was assured at the time that we were on track and on a steady path to get the certification from Lloyd's as well. And I don't believe we've got any surprises in that dimension.
Well, have you actually checked? Because this appears to have come out of the blue for you. although it shouldn't have come out of the blue, because the rules haven't changed.
No, it shouldn't. As I said, perhaps we were overconfident because of the 1261 being issued on the main staircases last November, and it was a surprise. At the time in May, June, somewhere around then, when I realised we got the MCA issues to solve, I also called the senior surveyor from Lloyds and said, this has surfaced with MCA. Is there anything from Lloyds that could similarly surprise me? He took a few days to go and investigate and came back and said, no, he didn't think so.
OK. Can you explain to the committee what the role of the Classification Society is?
A class society, whether it's Lloyd's Register, American Bureau Shipping, North Veritas, or any of the international societies, they publish rules for construction of vessels and notations for whether you want, for example, unmanned machinery space or built under survey. It's a well-proven process over a couple of hundred years. The client can always choose which classification society and which rules it wants to build its ships to, and CMAL chooses to specify Lloyd's Register. And the notation that we're required to achieve is specified in the contract.
Does the classification society have to sign off all the steelwork on the vessel?
Yes, the structural drawings, all the outfitting drawings, all the machinery drawings are all submitted to Lloyd's for plan approval in the early stages, and then the surveyors on site verify that we've built in accordance with the approved drawings.
So has that happened? Has all the steelwork on the hull, on the Glen Sannox, been signed off?
I'm not sure whether we have everything signed off at the moment. The surveyors are regularly on site, but it will be by the time we finish the vessel. I know that, we have just achieved Lloyd's sign-off on the starboard side of Glen Rosa, for example. They're just now surveying the port side.
OK. I'm just going to move on to one other area, Convener, if that's OK. Because you mentioned it, actually, Mr. Tideman, you have made a request to Neil Gray for extra money for the yard. Mr. Fairley mentioned the future of the yard, quite rightly. You have asked Neil Gray for extra money to essentially modernise the yard. Have you had a response to that yet?
No, it's still being considered by Mr. Gray and his department.
But it was pretty time critical, wasn't it?
The time critical element was the long lead time for a plating line. The manufacturer is Finnish and builds a plating line roughly every 6 months. And at the time we submitted the application in earlier this year, we were hopeful of placing a long lead time purchase order for the plating line and having delivery by December 24. We've now lost two slots since then, and earliest delivery would be December 25.
My understanding is you needed to get an order in this calendar year.
As months go by, we don't lose a month, we lose a six-month slot. So currently, if we could place an order in the next month or so, we could probably have the plating line installed by December 25. If it slips another couple of months, say towards Christmas, it might be summer 26 before we could have it installed.
So are you saying that Neil Gray needs to come back to you by when? End of November?
As soon as possible would be lovely.
And if that doesn't happen, what's the impact on the future of the yard?
Well, the productivity is low in the yard, as we know. Our pricing of the work for BAE, for example, we know we're not as competitive as other yards that have modern plating lines and modern facilities. It's the client's choice as to whether they can place all the work and pay a premium in some areas, so we are winning some work with BAE, even though we've got low productivity. Given that the plating line can't be installed for more than 2 years now, at the earliest, we will not get to decent productivity until 2026, which makes pricing work for BAE harder, makes pricing the small ferries harder. It's harder. The longer we postpone it, the harder it gets.
Yeah, I understand that because we've discussed this. But you know, we need a decision, is what you're saying. Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Graham. Jim, you wanted to come back with a follow-up.
It's just a follow-up, and it's a follow-on to what Douglas Lumsden was asking you earlier on. And again, this may be something that has been discussed in the past that I don't know about. You talk about these weekly, monthly meetings that you've had, and Douglas was referring to the fact that this committee didn't know about the rejection of year 1261, and you alluded to the fact that you waited till you found a solution. When you go to the government, is your point to tell them what your problems are? Because they're not going to come to you with a solution. You need to find the solutions yourself. So I presume that any delay isn't about trying to hide anything. It's about, right, well, I know what the problem is, but here's the solution. Is that, am I right in that assessment?
Yes, you are right. We have no reason to hide things. So as soon as I'm aware of an issue, I table it internally first with the management team in the weekly and monthly meetings with the sponsoring team. Sometimes there's a problem on the table for a while before we've come up with a solution, and therefore we can't price it until we know what the solution is.
Okay, thanks, Gabriel.
Thank you. Just looking around the committee if there's any other questions. I've just got a final one, David. It's the pricing of all of this seems quite opaque to me. So you've got the cost that you put out, plus the contingency plan, plus what I call the Derek Mackay loan. Then you've got the extra money that's been given to the yard. Then you've got some capital investment as well subsequent to that, which basically means to produce these ferries, I think we're talking about £175 million each for each of the ferries. That's roughly where I'm at. And that doesn't include any of the stuff that needs to be done in the harbours to make sure the harbours can take these boats, because we know that Ardrossan can't, and we know that there's no LNG tanks. So there's probably quite a lot of extra money in there, which is not part of this contract. But my question to you is, if each of these boats, Glen Sannox and 802, are worth or have cost £175 million to build, what will CMAL be putting them on their books at? What value will they be putting them on their books at? Because that's the value that they'll have to be insured at, and that's their true worth. So what do you think the true worth of those boats are? It can't be £175 million, surely.
I don't know what CMAL would... what decisions they'll make. That's up to them to do. I did say earlier that I thought a market price for this would be around £70 million if you were going to the market to buy one now. So that was the figure I put in my letter to the Public Audit Committee last December.
Effectively, it's costing us £100 million, which we've wasted on these boats, to get a boat that's worth £75 million. Or £175 million is what we've paid for a boat that's worth £70
million. Running the simple maths, that seems to be the answer.
Wow. Okay, if there's no other questions, I think thank you very much for coming and giving your evidence this morning. And I'm briefly going to suspend the meeting to allow you to depart and for the committee to take a break. 5 minutes, please, committee.